My name is Penny Smith.
And I'm Pam Smith, and we're in Orange at our cabin camp that was built by my father and uncle 60 to 70 years ago. And we've continued to maintain it. It has great sentimental value to us since it came down through my father's side of the family.
And we have pictures of my father and grandfather in making maple syrup. And then my father had another maple syrup shack out back that he made. There is out back where the pipeline would probably run a hand-dug, gravity-fed water line, which my father dug, then dug it across the road, and in the field opposite, he raised strawberries. He swamped a road by hand all the way to Warwick.
So we've continued to try to maintain. Obviously, we don't do maple syrup and strawberries, but we use it for hiking, snowshoeing, picking partridge berries to make berry bowls. And we use the camp periodically, fall and winter, not so much in the summer because of the bugs. And friends stay here. And a lot of people use the property for hunting.
And there are numerous brooks and streams, natural brooks and streams on the property. Growing up, there was a natural pond that he maintained as a skating rink for us. We had supper up here every single Saturday night with my mother's side of the family. The two families would get together and we had baked beans and hot dogs up here every single Saturday night. My father used this as sort of a retreat because he was the chief of police in town for a number of years. And since there was no phone up here, this is the one place he could come and sort of escape. And after he retired, he took up baking bread and on the wood stove.
Do you still have that wood stove?
Yes, we do. We still have the wood stove, the fieldstone fireplace.
Yeah, yeah.
We've, you know, recently updated all the chimneys on the wood stove, the fireplace, so that they're all secure, up to date.
Now, you talked about the water, the natural flowing water, the streams. Is that where Kinder Morgan wants to put their pipeline?
We're not exactly sure, but I'm sure it would affect it because the gravity-fed water line comes from way up the hill, and he had a tile that he sunk in like a little pond area
and put a foot valve pump on it.
And it feeds all the way down the hill, across the brook, and down so that it could come up in the camp.
And there's more than one brook on the property, so.
And those brooks, of course, go into other streams.
Right.
And eventually into the Quabbin, or?
I don't know that, to tell you the truth.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And he also, out here is like a little spigot where he hand dug, and I'm not exactly sure where that path is, but it was hand dug, and it goes.
The spigot on the opposite side.
Goes underneath the town road that he used to irrigate the strawberry patch. Yeah. So there's been a lot of, like, work.
So what happened when you heard that Kinder Morgan, how did you hear that Kinder Morgan wanted to put a pipeline through your property?
They came and asked a survey.
Uh-huh.
And we said no.
Uh-huh.
How did you know that you had the right to say no? Because some people...
We didn't know.
You just said no anyway.
Said no anyhow. The more I listened, the more I decided I was against it. And I wasn't giving any permission for anything until I knew more about it and had time to research it and
check with other people.
I said, I'm not signing for anything.
And so you haven't signed?
We have not signed. And they've contacted us two more times, but we've refused all times.
Right. And both of you are teachers in the high school there?
Right. Yes. We're starting our 42nd year.
And what do you teach?
English.
Both of you teach English at Mahar.
At Mahar, yes.
So has there been much, I guess it's been happening since this, more in the summer, but
right.
But you probably know other teachers and other parents and stuff at Mahar that also are being affected.
Yes, I don't know as much a personal impact. Uh-huh. Mike McGee definitely is well aware of the situation. He's made his classes aware of the situation so that mm-hmm. some of the students are certainly aware of
mm-hmm.
it
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and somewhat trying to be involved.
Have you written letters to the governor and stuff?
We have written letters to all 6 governors. We've written letters, like 21 letters, to all the state representatives and senators. We wrote additional letters to the governor upon request by another property owner on this road, telling more the personal story of mm-hmm. why this place means so much mm-hmm. to us and why we're opposed to the pipeline.
Yeah, good, good.
So is this, would you think of yourselves before the pipeline as political activists?
No. Definitely not. Yeah. Though very committed to the community, committed to community and school service. We try to do what we can to serve on town committees. We try to beautify Orange by doing the planting all the whiskey barrels and the hanging baskets.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
So definitely committed to the community, but really I enjoy the rural, peaceful nature of the whole town, but certainly here. And definitely not political activist.
So it seems like that wasn't a part of your history, but you certainly got into it.
Right.
So you're willing to go the whole way, whatever you have to do to fight this project?
Right? Yes.
Yeah, it means a lot to you.
And you know that there are people across the Commonwealth who are with you, both people who have property that would be affected, actually devastated,
right.
And then there are people like us who, it doesn't affect us personally, but it's part of the Commonwealth, and this is not something we want to see.
I've always been afraid of natural gas anyhow, even though I've had very little direct contact with it, but anytime you turn on the news, it seems as if there's a story of a gas explosion, and so it's something that scared me. And I didn't want any part of it, but we definitely have informed ourselves more since this started. I wasn't aware of all the chemicals that were released into the air. I wasn't aware of the chemicals that they used to drive the gas through the pipes, the frequency of the explosions, the leaks, etc., that we've now become aware of, which makes me even more opposed.
Very good. Well, we will do everything we can getting people throughout the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to stop this pipeline. So we're with you.
Good, thank you.
My name is Scott Haverty. I live here with my wife, Susan Atkinson Haverty. We've lived here for 14 and a half years. Bought this land and we built a home from scratch, and we take great pride in it. And it's been this bucolic, beautiful setting that we have up here is now endangered, and the pipeline will actually devastate our lives. Kinder Morgan can only compensate you, and they do that minimally for the tangible issues, which is the easement that they take. But what they can't what they can address in any form of compensation is how it affects your life. And I cannot live here peacefully with a surgical scar going through my land 130 feet outside my window. I'll see it every day. It'll be on my thoughts at night. Every waking moment, it will be on my mind. It just can't go through here. It just can't. It will devastate my life, my wife's life. It will make it intolerable to live here. And that's what it does to me personally. As far as the idea of the infrastructure of the Commonwealth being expanded, the more we expand things like pipelines, the less we move away from the agenda which is put forth by our governor for alternative energy sources. And that just pushes that timeline back and back and back, and we can't have that. So the idea is a pipeline, rethink the issue. If it's not part of a sustainable energy policy, then why do it? It doesn't make any sense. So the idea is, I'm against the pipeline, I'm against the technology of how we extract oil from the ground presently, but the idea is that things come sort of full circle, and we shouldn't allow it. We should make a stand on the infrastructure. Don't expand it. We have alternatives to it, very viable alternatives. It just takes a will to do it. And that's what I see as in shortcoming as far as the will. But pipeline, no, absolutely not, absolutely not.
Scott, I see we're in the middle of a very dense, beautiful forest.
Yes. Well, my wife and I, we bought 62 acres of land. And I have land on both sides of the road here. What drew us to the area was the forest. I mean, it's just beautiful, beautiful. There's wildlife and fisheries land on this side of the road also. There's state land to my northeast. And there's also large tracts of land, including the sisters next door who own 102 acres up there. And we've all been very, very cognizant of the minimal imprint that we make on the land. My wife and I have augment our heating source with wood. We've made a conscious effort to not take good species of trees. We make conscious effort to take species of trees that have been somewhat compromised by disease and natural forces. We haven't cleared the land. We don't have a formal lawn where we have to use certain products on the lawn. We've made a conscious effort not to do that, and now to have this pipeline come through, it's how we conducted ourselves up here now is like, it's a smack in the face. But again, you just listen here. This is what it's like all the time. This is beautiful. I've lived in the city. That's why I moved out. That's why we moved out. We lived in Petersham prior to this. We lived in Fitchburg and Leominster, too crowded. We moved to Petersham. Believe it or not, that got too crowded, even though there's only 1,000 people there. And we found this beautiful spot, and we're only 7 miles from the highway. It provides convenience to that route, but it gives us this 7 miles off the highway, and you think you're in the Upper Kingdom in Vermont. I mean, it's just beautiful, and it's hard for me to even contemplate losing it.
Have you spoken to your the governor or the representatives?
My wife and I have sent 2 letters to the governor's office.
Yeah.
All right. We get the typical response back that they're looking into all energy options and so forth, and that it's not a letter of it's a standard response letter, nothing specific to our issue.
Form letter.
All right. Yeah. Yeah. My letters have basically there are tangible ways it affects you, and is the intangible. For instance, Kinder Morgan, their compensation for the landowner is by linear foot. It's not by square footage. So they'll take 1,800 feet linear from me, 1,800 feet. They'll take an easement. They'll pay taxes on their linear foot. I pay taxes on the easement where I have restricted usage.
Oh.
So the idea is that I can't, how's the town going to compensate me as far as they assess my property? What a complex formula. That's not going to work out. So the idea is the landowner, everybody in Massachusetts or anybody who's going to, if the tariff is imposed, is going to pay a cost for it. Then you go to the directly affected people, the landowners. They will pay such a disproportionate cost, either tangibly or intangibly. The tangible issue is they're going to use my land. They're not going to pay full taxes for it. They're not going to compensate me adequately for it. The intangible, it's just going to devastate this setting that we've tried, that we fell in love with, and that we've tried to maintain. And you know, that to me is the biggest thing, is that it's just going to cease the existence that I have. And my wife and I love it up here. The dogs love it up here. It's just, I mean, what you, like I said, what you hear right now is what you get all the time, just nothing. It's just the birds, just the animals, and it's, you know, while I was waiting for you, there was a hawk no more than 30 feet from me, you know, nesting and flying around, and it was just beautiful. Occasionally you get the eagle flying up from the Quabbin, you know. We've had all sorts of animals here. It's just beautiful to see, and we don't hunt, we don't partake of that. We've just thought that it was a responsible way to deal with the environment that we've been given, and we were fortunate to come upon. And you know, it's just I know that there's very few landowners up here. There's a lot of usable land, as far as a lot of vacant land, uninhabitable. But I don't understand how a company can now view this land from above, and say, there's no homes here, but let's go buy this person's home here. It escapes me. It escapes me. It tells me that their initial survey was either strictly aerial or very cursory, or they just don't care. And I'm siding on the issue is that they just don't care. You know, they will exercise their right of condemnation, or commonly known as eminent domain. They will simply will do it in the most cost-effective way they can, and that means going past my home as opposed to someplace else. And I think there's a tension between agendas by other people. I think what you see is that you'll have people that want open space. Very admirable. We've tried to maintain open space up here. We live here, but we try to maintain open space. We try to be responsible to that concept. Environmentalists probably don't want the pipeline for many, many viable reasons. Open space people don't want the pipeline for their reasons. All right. So the idea is that if this is a public project, because all six governors have said, basically, yes, we need a pipeline, we need more natural gas service or transmission. Fine. That's a public mandate now. If it's a public mandate, why is it going through 1,600 people's private owner's land?
That's right.
It's a public project. It should go through public land, or not at all. Preferably not at all. But if it is public, but if it is a public mandate, public land should be, that option should be viable, and it should be explored more than just a cursory way that they're doing it right now. Obviously, the corporate mentality is the most cost-effective way to do it. If it's going to cost them more money, they will shy away from that and steer the argument someplace else. All right? But my central theme is, one, no pipeline at all. If the pipeline does show up, it should go through public land. That's my position.
Good.
Thank you very much.
We're at Winchendon in at Lucinda's backyard, where there's this beautiful pond, and she's got a canoe down there and an organic garden and hens across the street, and she lives in a beautiful colonial house, very beautiful old colonial house with her husband, and would be devastated by the pipeline coming through right through her property, right through her property.
I'm Lucinda Ellert. My husband is Dan Walker. We're here at the house at Gnarly Apple in Winchendon on Mill Glen Road, and we've lived here for about 2.5, a little more than that, years. We moved in the day after Thanksgiving, so November, whatever it was, in 2011, and we undertook the project of restoring this wonderful old house. and enjoying the pond and enjoying getting to know the people in Winchendon and starting to work on our 6 acres across the street that we want to develop and make use of. We heard about the pipeline, I think probably end of February. Remember, it was really, really cold. And the agent came to our door and told us this was going to be happening. My husband did a little bit of research initially and felt that from what he saw of the project, that it didn't seem to be too onerous. So we didn't really become concerned until a little bit later, not really until the first meeting that we had at beginning of May, I believe it was. But we were still not very keen on the idea. We had no idea of the scope of the project or how much it could potentially affect us. When we did find out, we of course became very concerned and threw ourselves wholeheartedly into protesting this, to just join this movement, this tremendous movement that's grown all the way across Massachusetts. And so we're very much a part of this. So how it affects us now emotionally, well, I'm very wrapped up in it. I would love to be doing other things with my time. I came out here to be in the beauty and to compose and to, you know, develop my musical talents. I'm a conductor and a church musician. And to just enjoy this. The pipeline, if it goes through, will go across. We have about 5 acres. We have 6.5 acres altogether. 5 acres is across the street from where we're sitting right now. And it would pretty well take out that entire 5 acres. When you consider the clear cut that they have to do to get their equipment in, and then to end up with a 50-foot wide easement, it still would cut down all those huge trees over the way. There's historic ruins across the way that it could impact. There's a brook on our property that it would impact. We have heritage apple trees across the street. We have plans to put in possibly a small cash crop. We wouldn't be able to support ourselves with this, but we're thinking hops. Putting in a hops field, a couple of acres over there. We have a large organic garden that we share with our neighbor across the street. And all of it would be wiped out, everything. The pipeline would go across those 5 acres and pretty well wipe us out. It would take out the organic garden, it would take out the apple trees, it would take out that possibility of having a hops field that we would have for the local breweries and organic, all organic. So the impact on us would be considerable from that respect. What we are very concerned about is the loss of property value and the loss, possibly the loss of insurance, and then our mortgage would be voided. It's a frightening prospect, especially when you consider that pretty much everything, all of our assets are tied up in this at the moment. We haven't had a chance to recover from the move and from a construction project that kind of went awry and that we have to raise funds to finish, and so on. But the property is well worth it. The house is more than 200 years old. It's historic. The features of the house are just beautiful. It's built before 1820. It was owned by the one of the first sawmill owners in Winchendon, John Poor. There's a little house next door, which was built actually roughly the same time that he built for his mother-in-law. So it's a mother-in-law's house. We have a plan to restore that and turn it into a guest house. Because the Denison State Park is only a mile and a half away. This is bikers' heaven out here. We know a million musicians that would just love to be able to get away, have a little place where they could practice, where no one's going to complain, and to be able to get on their bikes and get in nature, and fish off the dam, and so on. So we feel that that would be a very good way for us to be spending our retirement. The pipeline would destroy all of that. There'd be a scar across the street from us instead of beautiful woods and organic gardens and apple trees, of grass that is being loaded with chemicals. Nobody would come and stay here under those circumstances. So we would really wonder how we'd be able to recoup any of our funds that we have into this. I think that we would stand to be ending up in a trailer park someplace, living out our lives. I think that's probably our worst case scenario and our worst nightmare. So that's kind of basically the story.
Yeah. So how were you involved in stopping this pipeline?
Every way I can be, in every possible way. When we first really became aware of the scope of it and the potential for impact, for a negative impact on all of us along Mill Glen Road, I started investigating what other towns were doing, and I found that a lot of them were passing non-binding resolutions, and I said, well, why can't we do that here? So I went to the town hall, I researched the whole thing, I researched what the wording was for such a warrant. I found out what the town hall's requirements were to start a petition drive, to hold a town meeting. I wrote the warrant, got together with other members of our group. We reworked the wording so that it fit the needs of Winchendon. We got the petition out, we went out, we canvassed, we got all the signatures we needed, and last week we had our meeting and there was a unanimous approval of the ban on the pipeline. The selectmen in town have been amazing. They're really right on top of it. And their interests are for the people of Winchendon. And I'm really proud of this town. I feel like this has made me really a member of this community in a way that 22 years in Reading, I never really quite became. So it's very, there are good things. There are some really, really good things that come out of an experience like this. We just have to see it through and make sure that all of us succeed across the state.
So when you say see it through, what do you experience as the next steps? What are you anticipating as the next steps?
There are a lot of things that each of us can do and will continue to do. We sort of put this resolution to bed. So, and then there, of course there was the Boston Rally that was a huge event in our lives. I got together, since I'm a professional musician and so is my husband, we know a lot of people. We got together, a few people, to form a little jazz band to play for the rally, to kind of warm up the crowd and make it peppy and fun. So we called this the Fracked Gas Explosion Jazz Band. It plays old-time jazz in the style of Louis Armstrong. And so we went down and played for the crowd, and very appreciative crowd, I must say. Had a good time clapping their hands and singing along and all the rest of it. And out of that, we invented new words to an old song. And I'm not going to attempt to sing that on this camera, especially since I don't want to unveil it just quite yet. But we've got a project with a number of friends from actually across the state, musicians, people from various towns on the pipeline who are also musicians, and friends right here in Winchendon that are going to get together this coming weekend, and we're going to make a video of us and our protest. Not specific necessarily to Winchendon, not specific to Winchendon at all, and not even necessarily specific to the Kinder Morgan project, but about the real dead end that fracking is and how useless it is for us to continue to try to explore fossil fuels, an industry that's it's not going to go anywhere ultimately, and to encourage people to protest fracking and to really advocate for renewable resources, solar, wind, hydropower, whatever. I mean, there's so many possibilities. So we give information. We will be giving information about this this entire project and how damaging it is on so many levels. It isn't just about people and their property, but it's about what it does to the earth, what it does to the air, the false hope that it brings about jobs and about future for our children and our children's children. And we're just gonna film this, and then we're gonna sing this song. We're gonna put it on Facebook, and we're gonna encourage people to record their own version of the song. We're gonna open it up. This song is now yours. Record it, put it out there on Facebook, on YouTube, share it. We wanna try to see if we can't start a movement countrywide to let our legislators know that it's wrong for there to be this unholy alliance between huge corporations and the government, that this is a government for the people, and we live in a democracy, and we have to have a say about our community rights and about our rights as landowners.
Thanks. There's one thing that's been brought up recently, and I'm curious if you've talked about it or heard about it. That is, we're a commonwealth. We're one of the few commonwealths,
yes,
in the nation.
In Virginia, I think.
Yeah,
maybe
Virginia, Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania, okay.
But one of the truisms about a commonwealth is that in the towns or in the cities within the commonwealth, if the board of health says something is a health hazard, it can be prohibited from being in this town or city. And so one of the things that we're talking about in a number of towns is going to the Board of Health and to have the Winchendon, for example, or Board of Health look at the facts and determine that the Kinder Morgan pipeline in this case would be detrimental to the health of the people of Winchendon, and it would be prohibited from being here.
I think that sounds wonderful. I didn't know this, and you can bet I'm going to be looking into it and asking, you know, we'll bring it up in our group, and it sounds like a wonderful project to get started with. I'm on it. I'm in.
So there's just one other thing that among other things, an organic gardener, a provider perhaps of hops, but also a musician. And what I was struck by when you were talking about that is how many people who are involved in this have their work against the pipeline as an avocation, that this wasn't part of the plan.
No, that's for sure.
But what you're doing is you're bringing various talents, your musical talents, for example, to awaken people, to energize people, to inspire, and to encourage people to keep moving.
Yes, and I think music plays a huge role in that process. And if you look at any other community or civic or social or union type protest or movement in the past, music has been central to that. And I'm sure there are other musicians, and more power to them. Let's get together, everybody. The more we can have to make this happen and to wake people up, then I'm proud to be a portion of this. Yeah.